Maybe I should actually wear my glasses this video instead of just using them to make sure that I'm in view. Happy New Year. I don't know if I'm the only one like this. I'm probably not, but I feel like majority of people are like, oh, New Year, let's change things this year, let's do this this year. It's gonna be a whole brand new year. It's gonna be totally different than last year. And I understand that in the concept of time, but as I get older, I feel like it's just another year. Maybe I'm just like not in the season, I guess, of like whatever New Year's is. I understand the concept of starting something new or changing something up in your life, and I guess January 1st is just a great time to like start that. So maybe you're in that boat and you want to change some things up this year and do some things differently. Maybe it's change your hair, maybe it's change where you live, or just your attitude towards certain things, or it could be money. I think a lot of people like to start new financial goals at the beginning of a year, which I think is a fabulous thing. So I thought that the new year would be a really good time for me to do this video that I've been planning on doing for like 6 months now. I just haven't gotten around to it, but now I'm getting around to it and I want to talk about money. Money is this huge, uncomfortable topic. Majority of people don't like to discuss money, and I actually enjoy talking about money. I can't say I've always been like that, but I can say that now I have no qualms or issues talking about money, talking about our financial situation. I don't go into details. I won't talk about how much Eli makes. I won't talk about how much we have left over. I don't talk about how much our mortgage is. I won't go into those kind of details, because I don't think those details are necessary to talk about money. So I as well will not be going into those details today. I don't think money should be this conversation that doesn't happen. I think that we should talk about money. We should be honest about money. Money can be a really great thing. Money is a very, very good tool, and it is important to keep it that way as a tool and not to abuse the tool or to use it wrongly. Just like how we would take care of our tools that we have in our garage, we need to take care of our money and have respect for that money and see the, not to be punny, but the value in a dollar. I'm not gonna talk to you about RRSPs or RESPs or TFSAs. I'm not a bank teller. I'm not specializing in finance, but I do have a very knowledgeable mother who has taught both myself and my siblings growing up about money. Anything I say today that makes sense and sounds good and is like, oh, that's common sense, came straight from my mom. So don't think that I'm this like super smart person. I'm not. I just learned from my mom. My mom taught me. I figured this is probably important information, and I'm still learning from my mom. So this is kind of like a video dedicated to you, Mom. I wouldn't be able to film this video if it wasn't for my mom having taught me so many things when it comes to finances and budgeting and saving and priorities. And growing up, I don't think in our home we ever didn't talk about money. Money was never a, you know, oh, you don't talk about that. It was always a very open conversation, as was basically anything in our family growing up. My parents were very honest about their financial situation. We grew up single income. My dad went out to work and my mom stayed home and was a stay-at-home mom, homeschooled us kids the whole way through. Well, the whole way through grade school, I should say. We weren't homeschooled for university. I don't think you could even do that. Well, I guess everyone's kind of doing that right now. But like, you know what I mean. We didn't grow up rich. I think you could classify us as middle class, I think is the proper classification for what our family was financially growing up. We were never lacking. We live in BC, which is insanely expensive. Like, it's, people are just everywhere, just tossing away all their hard-earned cash because food costs a lot and houses cost a lot. And oh my goodness, insurance for vehicles costs a lot. Don't get me started. So we're definitely in a place where it's very expensive to live here, and my mom was like the wizard when it came to managing the money that my dad worked very hard for. But very easily, we could have had $100,000 of credit card debt. And I say we like it was me, but it wasn't. It was my mom and dad. Like, they very easily could have been in a lot of debt if they had handled financially themselves differently than they did when we were growing up. But they were very responsible with this tool of money. And because of that, my dad was able to retire earlier than most people are. And my parents had paid off their house earlier than most people do. My mom was able to take the hard-earned cash that my dad made and spend it responsibly so that we were not lacking. So they were very open and honest with us, I think, that I can recall when it comes to money. And I, as well, am very open and honest about money, what we can afford, what we can't afford. It doesn't hurt me to, like, be hang out with my girlfriends and be at a store and see, like, I don't know, a really nice jacket and go, oh, it's so beautiful, but we can't afford it. It doesn't hurt me to do that. It doesn't embarrass me. It doesn't make me feel like, oh, we can't afford this. It's a $100 jacket. I can't afford that. And I don't mind that. Now, would I actually technically be able to afford the $100 jacket? Okay, yes, I could. I could spend the $100 on this jacket plus tax and still pay bills, but not as much money will go into savings. And that may not be the best way to spend my husband's hard-earned money. And when I say spend my husband's hard-earned money, I don't mean it in a way of, like, you know, that Eli is this, oh, I make the money and you can only spend, like, here, darling, have some, like, dimes and this is your allowance for the year. No, that's not how our relationship works at all. Eli earns money and he entrusts me to spend all of it well. And frankly, I could buy, like, tons of stuff and he would never know because he doesn't look at any of our banking stuff. I take care of all of it. This is a really long intro. It's probably because of how I was raised, but I like using money properly as a proper tool. And so when I stopped working and was a stay-at-home mom, well, first I was on sick leave when I was pregnant with Bev because I couldn't work because I had a really rough third trimester. I haven't been working since then. And it was really difficult for me because I find going to work, working for a full day, and getting a paycheck so unbelievably satisfying. So I was no longer doing that. I was just at home. And I realized that I could actually still contribute financially to our family by spending that money that Eli worked very hard for properly and responsibly. So that's how I contribute financially to our family. Eli and I are, if you couldn't guess already, we're on a single income. Even though I do YouTube and I do Instagram, I don't make money off Instagram. I've only just barely, like less than a month ago, started making a tiny bit of money off of YouTube. It's not a lot at all. I'm not complaining about that. I'm very thankful that I get to make a tiny bit on YouTube, but I'm just trying to be open and honest as to what our financial situation is, because I could say we're on single income and it could be my income and I could be making hundreds of thousands of dollars every year doing YouTube. I'm not. I don't even know how much I make. Not a lot. It's really, really, really small. I could probably buy a coffee with the money that I've made thus far on YouTube. And Eli has a great job. He's not a lawyer. He's not a doctor. He doesn't make, like, buckets and buckets and buckets of money, but he's set. He has a really great job for being 25. We're set for life with his work, but we are probably as well considered middle class for how much Eli makes. And just how it was in my family growing up, it would be very easy for Eli and I to have a lot of debt. Just because of where we live, like, the housing market is so outrageously expensive. Food prices keep going up. Gas is not pretty. We live in Lower BC. It is expensive here. If we could move somewhere else in Canada where it was not as expensive to live and I could take all of my friends and all of my family and all of our church family and Eli's job and my, like, local grocery store and my local coffee shop, so I could, like, pick us all up and move us on over, like, somewhere really, really cheap, I would, but I can't. So that's just not gonna happen. But this is where we live. And so for Eli and I to be 24 and 25, to have three kids, be on a single income and have no debt is quite a great accomplishment. The only debt we have, which I consider to be a good debt, there's bad debt and there's good debt. And that's something my mom taught me. Whoop, hold on. Meredith's waking up, just a second. Meredith is gonna join us. So yes, there's good debt and there's bad debt. And a good form of debt is a mortgage. That is something where you're investing in yourself. So yes, we do have a mortgage, we do have that debt, but it's not like it's credit card debt, which is just gnarly. This still is my intro. I'm not even getting into my tips yet. I should really get to my tips, shouldn't I? It's like, you know that Mama's doing a video and you just want to come and join me. Stand here for a little bit, my dear. So to say that the only kind of debt we have is a good debt is a really positive. And again, I'm not trying to toot. Ooh, she's trying to toot. I'm not trying to toot my own horn. Anything that I am able to accomplish financially is A, because my mom taught me how to manage funds, and B, because my husband is such a hard worker and provides that money for us. All right, so let's get started with tips. So these are just kind of rules that I follow, that I live by when it comes to budgeting, saving, spending. It's things that I think about every time I am planning out a month or a week of either groceries or bills or finances. So let's just jump in. Credit cards are evil. Okay, they're not actually like evil, like demonic evil, but the problem with credit cards is that it's so easy to just keep swiping and tapping because it feels like it's unlimited money. One of the big things I follow is I never spend more than what is in my checking account. A credit card is not free money. In fact, it is one of the worst forms of interest you can have. I cannot stress this enough. Only spend what is in your checking account. If you have $20 in your checking account, your bill for your Visa or your MasterCard or whoever you're with should not be more than $20. In fact, you should try to make it less if you can. The problem with credit card debt is that it's very, very hard to get out of. I've never had to get out of that pit of credit card debt. I do know families and people and stories, and even just knowing what interest rates are on credit card debt is like, it's atrocious. And I can imagine, and I have heard and I have seen that it is so difficult to dig yourself out of that very deep, fast deepening pit. So only spending what you currently have in your checking is massively important for you to stay out of debt or to get out of debt. It's important to only spend what you have. And I know it can be kind of annoying to like go onto your bank account site, like I do online banking, and it can be, you know, a bit of a to like go online and go to your account and see what's going on and go here and go there. But do it. Take the time to do it. It'll take you 5-10 minutes max. And then you'll know how much you spent on your credit card, how much you have in your checking, how much more money you can spend on your credit card, or if you should really just stop. She's just chatting away with you guys. You chatting? Hello. Another great thing about maintaining that idea of only spend on your credit card what you have in your checking is that it shows the bank that you're responsible with your money. If you have a good credit score, you're more likely to get a better mortgage or a better loan if you need it. So in short, only spend what you have in your checking. Don't look at your credit card as if it's free money, because it's not, and it's going to pull you down a very deep pit, very hard to get out of. And by spending your actual money responsibly, the bank is going to notice that, they're going to see it, and you're going to be more likely to get approved for a loan or a mortgage, which I mean is a loan, than you would be if your credit score was low and you were clearly spending irresponsibly. It's kind of off of the last point, but another way that I have managed to keep us out of debt is avoiding interest at all costs. The second I get my statement for credit cards, I write down on my planner when a bill is due. And 5 days, I go back 5 days, and then I write down when to pay it. And I pay it in full, to the penny, never pay less, never pay the minimum, because that's the credit card debt that's going to just pull you down. I do things like I set up automatic payments for, say, my phone bill, for my phone bill and Eli's phone bill on the day it's due immediately. Our credit card is automatically set up to pay our phone bill in full. You can also set up pre-authorized full payments on other bills through your bank, depending on which bank you have. Most banks don't want you to know that because they make their money off of that interest. A lot of them are slimy and they want you to be paying interest. So they don't advertise that you can do pre-authorized payments to pay in full your bills when they're due. But you can set that up. One time I forgot about a bill. I didn't write it down and I was 1 day late and I felt sick. Paid it off. There was interest. I paid it. Never had to do that ever again, because from that point on I felt so sick that I was like, this can never happen again. So I made sure I always write down dates when bills are due, go back 5 days, pay it that day. Another way that I am able to save money is by doing the coupons and doing the points programs. I have saved a lot of money by doing coupons and by doing points. There are different apps that allow you to have either coupon codes, or certain stores will price match with other stores, and there are apps that will download like every single flyer for every single store around you and you can price match. It takes a little extra time to find the deals, but it is worth it in the end when you save like 10 bucks. I also love my points program and I will often plan meals based off of the points offers that I have. So if I have a deal on sour cream and like a deal on tomatoes and a deal on tortillas, guess what I'm making? Tacos. The biggest way and the most effective way I'm able to stay out of debt is budgeting. And I budget according to priorities. So I make sure that there's always going to be money for the mortgage. I have to make sure there's money for our bills, which I can never know the exact amount, but we tend to spend the same every month so I can approximate it. There are things like donations, charitable donations, groceries, insurance, all those sorts of things that are priority. I mark them all down. And then once I see how much is left over after paying all those things and subtracting all that from our estimated income for the month, I see how much is left over. From that, I put money into savings. And then if a hefty amount goes into savings, then it's like, okay, we'll go out for dinner one week. We can go out for like a coffee date. All the luxury stuff comes after or doesn't even exist depending on how much money I put to savings. You can give yourself an allowance for luxury spending, like, hey, 50 bucks a month you have to buy coffee for the month. You know, like to go out and actually purchase a coffee. If you buy $5 coffees, then that's 10 coffees in a month, and that's pretty good. But you don't want to overspend that. A good idea could be to take it out in cash every month. So that's what I do. I budget according to priority. And if there isn't any money at the end of the month, if I only have like $100 left after all the bills and other necessities, and I still haven't put money into savings, well, that $100 is going into savings, and we'll just eat Mr. Noodles on the nights that we're supposed to eat out. It may suck in the moment. It might be annoying and like, oh, like I was really looking forward to my coffee, or I was really looking forward to like buying this shirt that I had my eye on. But think long-term goal. What is your long-term goal? Is your goal to just spend money willy-nilly? Is it to get out of debt? Is it to have your own home one day? Is it to buy a nice car? Think of your long-term goal. For me, here's what I think about. We are now, this home that we're in is not a long-term plan. It may be a longer plan than we think it is. It could be a shorter plan than we think it is, but it's not forever. So my personal goal is that when we leave here, we will buy another house, obviously, with a nice yard that like isn't in the middle of a busy neighborhood. And I would like to be able to buy a fixer-upper and fix up that house and make it exactly how Eli and I would like it to be, and to have the funds to do that, to have the money right up front and be able to not save up for different projects, but be able to just do them off the bat. And we would like for that to be our forever home and never have to move again. That's the goal. So I've even had, oh my goodness, guys, Boxing Day sales. Don't get me started. I saw so many Boxing Day sales where I was like, oh, it's 20% off, it's 30% off, it's 40% off. I wanted to buy that stuff, man. I so badly did. I wanted to buy super cute like shirts. I wanted to buy the clothes for the girls. I wanted to buy new bedding. I wanted to do all this stuff and I didn't, because in my head I went, dream house, that's my end goal. And because I have that in my mind, I went, not gonna buy any of this other stuff. And I did not buy anything. I was so proud of myself. Because it's difficult, because I like nice things. I like having cute things. And I'm not gonna buy something if it's cheap and not worth it. But I didn't buy anything, and it's gonna be totally worth it. One of the last things that Eli and I do to maintain no debt is to avoid bad debt-causing purchases. Now, these aren't all bad. I know couples who have these different purchases and they do totally fine financially. They're not in debt, they're good. But for us, it's just ones that we avoid. We don't want to have these kind of purchases or these kinds of debts, because we, in the end, want to put that extra money that we could be spending on those debts, we want to put that to the side in savings instead. I mentioned before that a mortgage is a good form of debt. I still hold to that, because it's only been like 10 minutes since I said that. But mortgage is a good debt. Car payments are not. And I'm probably going to raise a lot of like reactions towards that statement. Here is my reasoning for that. If I have a car, brand new, off the lot, it's beautiful, oh my goodness, luxurious, fancy, leather seating, all the Star Wars kind of buttons that make you feel like $1 million. Let's say that costs me $400 a month for 5 years. That is $400 a month that I either can't put in savings or can't spend on groceries. I have to put it towards the vehicle. And if I have only $400 left after doing all of my other priorities, spending, budgeting, bills, and so on and so forth, and I only have $400 left, but I still have car payment and I have savings. Savings isn't gonna get any money that month. I'm gonna spend it on my car payment. So I avoid that altogether by buying secondhand vehicles. I have owned 2 vehicles in my life. Both of them were secondhand. It has taken the occasional maintenance like most vehicles do, and because I don't spend money on it every month, I get to put that money into savings or spend it on a night out with Eli. So that for me is just more worth it. That's my personal preference. That's not everybody's. And again, I know people who pay monthly payments. They're all good and they still have some money to go on a date night once a month. But in my personal preference, that's another way I stay out of debt. Other sorts of debt we avoid is paying for furniture in installments, or in fact buying anything where I have to pay it in installments. I know for myself in other things, not financially specifically, but if it comes to a list of things I have to do in a day and it's a lot, I can very easily feel overwhelmed where I don't do it. I won't do anything on the list. I'll just sit on my butt and be lazy because I just feel so overwhelmed and like afraid of this list and intimidated by it. And I've gotten a lot better lately where I will just tackle the list. I'll just start with the one thing. And I think finances and debt and getting out of debt or staying out of debt is similar. I would imagine, I can't speak for myself, but I would imagine that looking at say $50,000 credit card debt is a very, very big mountain that you feel like you have to climb. And it is a big mountain you have to climb, but the important part is taking the first step. Maybe it's getting rid of your vehicle that you pay monthly installments on. Maybe it's not going out to eat every week. There are sacrifices you can make in order to get out of debt. It is possible. There are some months where all of a sudden we have to pay a lot of money to do vehicle maintenance. That kind of comes out of nowhere. We're not expecting it. Hello, you're cute. And it's like, okay, so this is gonna cost us X amount of money. That's a lot. Babe, we're having hot dogs and we're having Mr. Noodles and we're gonna have pasta and we're gonna have sandwiches for dinner for the next 3 weeks. And that's totally fine. You gotta make sacrifices. That's just how it goes. And nobody can make you make those sacrifices. You have to decide to do them yourself. You have to be dedicated to it. You gotta be committed to getting out of debt. Committed to getting out of debt. And I would really encourage you, if you're struggling financially, to take a look at your monthly spending and your finances and think of where you can make some cuts and how you can slowly just take that first step and that second step and the third step and climb up that mountain and get out of debt. I've read so many different articles and blog posts about people who are in so much debt, whether it was school debt or credit card debt, and committing themselves to getting out of debt and doing things like not eating out anymore, getting rid of one of their vehicles, not going to see movies, riding their bike to work when they could. There are so many different ways people have been able to get out of debt, massive amounts of debt, and they've done it. And some people do it in a year, some people do it in 2 years, but oh my goodness, 1 or 2 years compared to the rest of your life is tiny. Y'all got this. Get yourselves out of debt. Can you see mama? And I do want to make a point that I understand it is different for different people in different places. I'm not going to talk your ear off more than I already have. Those are my tips. Those are just some very basic, easy ways of how we've been able to stay out of debt. And thus far, it's been tried and it's true. Is that how you do it? It's true and it's tried and true? Tried and true? How many more times can I say that? Tried and true, tried and true, tried and true. Thank you so much, guys, for clicking on this video. If you have any other tips as to how you stay out of debt or how you got out of debt or how you're managing your debt, please comment them down below. I would love to read them. I'm sure most other people would as well. I hope you had a very happy new year and I will see you guys in my next video. Bye. Ready? We do this. We take our hand, we open up our hand like this, and we go, bye.